Late Monday evening, the Space Shuttle Columbia came out of hiding. Until then, the orbiter had been linked umbilically to the rotating service structure, providing liquid oxygen and hydrogen for Columbia's fuel cells. The retraction of the RSS revealed the gleaming white body of the world's most unique spacecraft. Final checks and counterchecks were being made, and Joe Engel and Richard Truly, who will fly the orbiter, were already on site at the Kennedy Space Center. By daylight, with the launch less than a day away, no technical problems remained, just meteorological. NASA Test Director Norm Carlson.
Okay, I think our problem here as far as the icing is concerned is the ice, the possibility, if we have rain in the area, moisture on the outside of the external tank, which in turn would we would have an ice buildup. And the reason we don't want the ice buildup, of course, is that at ignition we have a vibration in which the ice would come loose and have the possibility of damaging the orbiter tile.
So far, weather forecasters have been preaching optimism and delivering less than convincing reasons for it. There are several wild cards in the shuttle launch equation. The formation of ice is one of the most major, but heavy cloud cover would also be a problem, and so too would these consistent winds which seem to blow through the Cape Canaveral area. Depending on severity, any of these problems could delay the launch several hours to several days. But once the Space Shuttle orbiter Columbia is again airborne, the sight will be spectacular.
We've gone for main engine start. We have main engine start. The tower.
As Columbia flew last April, NASA was content to prove its new spacecraft could operate successfully. This time, the orbiter will have greater objectives. Once in orbit at 137 nautical miles above the Earth, Columbia will begin several experiments. Of primary importance is the evaluation of the shuttle's ability to serve as a steady platform for Earth-viewing investigations. For the first time, payload bay doors will be opened and a remote manipulator arm will be tested that could someday deploy and retrieve satellites in orbit. One other objective is to demonstrate that the more the shuttle is used, the easier it gets. NASA's Hugh Harris says that's already happened in launch preparations.
It goes all the way from just receiving the orbiter here at the Kennedy Space Center up to the time we move it out to the pad. For instance, on the first launch, we spent about... it was more than a year in the orbiter processing facility, and during this particular period we only spent about a little over a month in the orbiter processing facility. So we compressed the time in which we did the work there tremendously. We believe that we can cut it down to about a little over 3 months for this next launch. We're about 6 months in between launches this time, and then we will cut it down gradually from then on until we reach whatever it is. It might be a month. We would like to get it down to 2 weeks.
Assuming the weather cooperates and Columbia returns safely from her journey as she did last April, we will learn a valuable and historic lesson. For the first time, a spacecraft will have been reused, ultimately leading to economical and routine use of space. So when Columbia next leaves this launch pad, it will be another first for America. Bryce Zabel reporting from Kennedy Space Center, Florida. As the space shuttle waited on launch site 39A, there was little hint of what was in store. Bathed in xenon lights, America's newest spacecraft seemed a picture of perfection. NASA engineers even worried out loud that things might be going too well. Media representatives from all over the world converged on the grandstand area of Kennedy Space Center to witness the launch. The occasion would be historic, proof that the reusable spacecraft concept worked. But the proof was not forthcoming from the Columbia. The countdown continued with only a few minor problems, which were easily solved. NASA's big concern remained the weather. But even that problem was put aside when air surveillance provided the confidence to proceed with launch. All systems were go. And they stayed that way until 31 seconds before liftoff.
An evaluation is being made as to why the countdown has held at the T-minus 31 second point. We believe that it is because the tanks on the fuel cells pressure is not cleared with the redundant set sequencer.
Hearts that had been pounding with excitement fell with disappointment. Finally, the mission was postponed until later in the day, then scrubbed altogether. The decision came not because of weather, but because the lubricating oil pressure in two of three fuel cells was too high. The launch would not happen for at least 48 hours while NASA planned its next move. Stopping the clock at 31 seconds and scrubbing the launch naturally comes as a big disappointment, not only to those of us in the media, but also the public, NASA engineers and technicians, and especially astronauts Engel and Trulli. But the launch was scrubbed. It's a testament that the space shuttle, magnificent machine it may be, is still a new unproven spacecraft, and NASA is taking no chances. Bryce Abel reporting from Kennedy Space Center, Florida. Wednesday morning, November 4th, a textbook perfect countdown begins on schedule. The only clouds on the horizon are literally the clouds on the horizon. But even the weather cooperates then, and mission control says go. The computer, however, spots some dirty oil filters and says stop, and at a heartbreaking 31 seconds before liftoff.
An evaluation is being made as to why the countdown has held at the T-minus 31 second point. We believe that it is because the tanks on the fuel cells pressure is not cleared with the redundant set sequencer.
After that disappointing postponement, NASA began checking and double-checking its systems in preparation for this latest attempt. And it seems a $25 oil change could very well have prevented a delay with a price tag of close to $2 million. With that in mind, NASA entered into its second launch attempt in as many weeks. Soon, by working day and night, the Columbia was once again ready, and so too was her crew, astronauts Joe Engel and Richard Trulli. Trulli, who celebrated his 44th birthday on launch day. The cast of characters was the same, but the script had been rewritten. Still very high on drama, it called for the failure of two MDMs, small electronic data links. Replacements were cannibalized from the Challenger, Columbia's sister ship, and flown in from California. By morning, the countdown really was going smoothly, and shortly after 10 a.m. Eastern time, 7 months to the day after her first flight, Columbia flew again.
We have go for main engine start. We have main engine start. Minus 3, 2, 1. We have ignition. We have ignition of the solid rocket boosters and liftoff. Liftoff of America's space shuttle, and the space shuttle has cleared the tower.
Houston now controlling. The mission control confirms roll maneuver started. 20 seconds, thrust looks good. 25 seconds, roll maneuver completed. 30 seconds, Columbia now 1 nautical mile in altitude.
It's hard to find the words to describe the impact of an event such as this. You must have seen it on your television screen now, and clearly the power must have come through that screen. But in person, it's awesome. The ground shakes like the rumble from an earthquake, and there's a roar, and there's excitement knowing that there are men on top of this spacecraft, men that are on top of what is no doubt the world's largest Roman candle. Well, it's almost enough to make you lose sight of the fact that this is primarily a mission of science, not a mission of adventure, and this mission has just begun. Unlike the first mission, which was content to prove the Columbia could reach Earth orbit and return safely, the second flight will demonstrate the spacecraft can perform necessary missions. Perhaps the most visible addition is the Canadian-built remote manipulator system, the 50-foot crab-like arm used to deploy and retrieve payloads. It can't support its own weight on Earth, but in orbit it's expected to be a valuable tool. In addition, for several days, a package of scientific experiments will scan the Earth 137 nautical miles below the Columbia. One instrument will look for algae in the deep water zones of the Pacific and Atlantic Oceans. Another sensor will measure carbon monoxide in the atmosphere, and three others will be involved with mapping rock formations associated with mineral and oil deposits. And then, 5 days, 4 hours, 10 minutes, 83 revolutions around the Earth after being launched, Columbia will return with its information. The return will be almost identical to that of the first flight, deorbit burn over the Indian Ocean, entry into the atmosphere over the Western Pacific, and a touchdown at Edwards Air Force Base in California's Mojave Desert. Nonetheless, this latest liftoff already puts Columbia in the history books. It's the first time a used spacecraft has gone back to space. Bryce Abel reporting from Kennedy Space Center, Florida.
Houston, controlling. Mission control confirms roll maneuver started.